We all know about the stuff we put through people's letter boxes that are never read. I think there needs to be some way to think what was very clear is a face-to-face. Is there another way that we can do more face-to-face stuff? A lesson learned from West Hendon and taken into generation states. I don't know how you do that, but I've stuffed enough these letters to letter boxes in my entire life that people will use them.
Just to make sure that everyone's aware, the new temporary community centre at West Hendon, which is in the bottom of the new block, right in the heart of the community, does have a Metropolitan Housing Association officer facing there, and that's the main place he works for, and he's quite there in time, he's there most days. And so my colleagues from the Green work there, and they tend to make sure that someone there 1 or 2 days a week. So there are frequently people on the estate physically, and residents, we do know to drop in and ask questions just because you can see the footfall through the community centre. There are a lot of people going in and taking advantage of that. So I totally accept that newsletters are always the most effective way. They are an effective way, but also do have a lot of opportunities for people to go and talk to officers.
I know that in James Estate, in Dogs Creek and Tesco's, they got some open, but they don't actually know that anyone's there. Maybe there's a way of working with the local community that you do like a sort of a listing of events that's advertised, so doing this once a month.
Thank you. I think it's important to stress this report is one appendix, but it covers 5 aspects of engagement through different forms and different forums. Most of which are actually face to face, is one newsletter, yes, but the others are face to face groups. They're quite targeted groups. And we have people like Bloodjazz who are advocates for the fellow residents. But as you can see, they are regular actually, and they do raise issues. And they will be, I've lived through half of the regeneration scheme, and it is noisy, there are issues as well, but they are unavoidable, unfortunately, and they will be things cropping up. Are there other comments? Is this report always a note? So can we just note the reports? Are we happy members to note the reports? There's no mistakes. Yes, thank you. Okay, so item 7 is noted, and Councillor Ward is coming back into the room. We now move on to the item 8, the regeneration strategy. So we're starting to draw up a new strategy for 2019-2029. This is the very first early stages. Paragraph 1.5 has the emerging themes, paragraph 1.7 and the scope and the structure. These have very much been drawn up by officers at this stage, and we have had some involvement with the themes as well. But tonight is about talking about the high level themes and the structure, so that when this progresses, we can add what we need to add to that. And you've got paragraph 4.2, all the key milestones. This is quite a lengthy process, it should be published in March 2019, so it's very early stages at the moment. But I certainly welcome comments or proposals from members. Absolutely.
Yeah, well, I think it's good to have a strategy. I think we won't go over West Hendon again, but it is good to have actually hopefully learn from where we've not got it and the things like in the past. I would say, in terms of paragraph 1.5, it covers the emerging themes. I think there are a couple of things I think I would suggest we might want to add into that. I think the pollution in the environment isn't there, and I think that is something that we ought to have to cover in the strategy. And there's also given that, people are concerned with air quality, given that actually there's also the environment in terms of how the build-out happens, and you've experienced that, because Jasmine referred to it as an ongoing issue back then. So I think there needs to be an addressing the environmental and pollution issues, both with the actual work that happens, and also what you want to end up with, a clean, really nice state. That should be something that the strategy does mention. Physical and social infrastructure, I think we ought to be clear about community spaces being part of that. I think in relation to integration of town centres and whether it's business, but also generally, there should be a reference to working with communities and partnership working in a way, because I think that's something we talk talked earlier about town centres and briefly members had. One of the things I think, when, you know, one good example in North Finchley was, well, as you remember, where Barbara Lacks the House actually was a very involved process. I think the town team didn't work, and I'm not going to get into it. You know, actually, I mean, genuinely, if you bring communities with your businesses and people who know the area, it's actually experts living in the place, people live there. That's an important thing to get right, and you have to work on that. So that's one sort of suggestion. I think I would say the housing is down there, but I would say actually two aspects of housing need to be particularly drawn out of, you know, housing that is affordable to rent or buy. I think that's going to be something that we have as a desirable part of our regeneration strategy. I also think the afford. The other thing I think we clearly have to have in there is how we communicate, because it's about regeneration with existing communities, and how we ensure that the affordability issues raised by residents, leaseholders and existing residents, are taken on board, because that is one of the most... So I think the strategy has to address that. The other thing I would say is, Jasmine raised the issue around support and community and affordability and adaptations, and clearly the other thing for existing residents are important. I would also say that the strategy should refer to the Mayor of London strategy. And at the end of the day, we need to learn from what's happened across London, and also, to some extent, the Mayor of London strategy is there, and we do have to abide, we are expected to abide by it. So I think there are a number of things that strategy I want to see in this strategy. So, at this stage, what this document is to go forward, and clearly we will be putting in comments about what we think should be in the strategy. I mean, I don't know whether it's going to be a working group or whatever, but I do think, so at this stage, we do support the need for a strategy. I think I've raised some of the issues, I think, of the things that we ought to be addressing in that strategy. I suspect, there are other issues that we might disagree on. We've raised the issue of existing investment guidelines for light placement, because that's something that we would want to see in our regeneration strategy. So, some of these you might agree with, some of them you might agree with, but I think those are starting point from us in terms of things that we think this document should address. Whether it does address those is another matter. Hopefully the final document will. But I do think some of those, hopefully, there will be cross-party support for, so being included. I realise that's very early stages.
Thank you. We are taking notes. Councillor
McGill. I mean, I think that the graph chart doesn't necessarily match 1.4 to 1.5. There are things in 1.5 that aren't in 1.4, and vice versa to a certain degree. There's one big omission, which, I'm not on that committee anymore. There's one big omission is education and learning. When you're building virtually new towns, part of that infrastructure has to be around education and learning. You've got in the engineering commissioning plan performance report, we are worsening on apprenticeships. And I think that should be part of the regeneration strategy. In 1.7, we put thematic strategies. Because we have a committee system, Councillor Houston alluded to it, but having taken the working group out, because there are clearly things in the regeneration strategy that just aren't this committee of policy and resources. There are themes that need to be. The other thing is just, we're struggling to collect bins, as it were, without expanding the amount of people that live in this. So there is also the environment stuff, there's also the infrastructure based around how we tackle street scene stuff should be in there. And that should be the thematic approach of how are we going to actually bring the theme committees engaged into this. I remember donkey years ago, we used to do the strategic plan. I think we forced every officer and every themed committee to come in here. Well, you have to be involved in this because it affects your service area. If we're building new town centres, that position would be right across. You need to be engaged, and there's also councils who engage that need to be included in as well. That's my notice.
Thank you. I think some of those points do come under the physical and social infrastructure. And
it's not,
So you're drilling down into the detail that we're looking for, which we welcome, but we're certainly not ignoring those areas. And indeed, you know, our agencies are seeing all sorts of infrastructure installed, whether it be community centres or schools, or what have you. And they have been, they've been apprenticeships as well. We'll come on to the performance side of apprenticeships a bit later on. And I think one of the things that sort of Kath and I have noticed is that our outcomes and nurturing teams are not very much what we want to achieve. And what we're getting a sense of is how we achieve it, of course. And a lot of things that certainly Councillor Houston was talking about was actually the experience of living through regeneration. Because it was living through it, whether it be existing tenants, moving tenants, new tenants as well, and homeowners. So it's how we make that. And indeed, Red Cross, they're already considering that, how they face temporary open spaces, and through the phase that you can make an attractive, pleasant as possible, regeneration scheme. So we need to bring that together in this report, and I'm grateful for members bringing that to the fore. Any other comments on the paper as it stands? Councillor Zinkin.
I would just add to what you said, but of course the impact of these schemes is not only on the people who are living in the middle of them, particularly with the Red Cross, but it will also affect the surrounding area. And therefore, to the extent that we are worrying about the living conditions of those living through it in the middle of the scheme, I think we also need to add to that those in the wider area where traffic and other considerations would be a major issue.
Okay. Councillor Houston.
I'm actually thinking of the other thing, quite Red Cross is an example where we have to also consider as good neighbours, people in neighbouring boroughs and how it impacts them.
Yes.
So,
thank you. I'll propose then. There's only one recommendation that we agree that was proposed in the report. Kath and I have taken notes, and as far as we can, we will incorporate that in the next stages and the next issues of this. But as this goes forward, the detail will be debated, obviously, far more in depth and perhaps even more rigorously as well. So can I ask for a vote on the recommendations as they stand? Those in favour, please show. Okay, that's unanimous. Thank you. Lovely. And we'll continue on that good faith going forward. So that's item 8.